All right, just listening to the Giants game wind up here. Pablo Sandoval just hit a two-run homer in the ninth inning with one out. And so, you know, stuff can happen late in the game, right? Let me turn this down here. And it's Mayday, Mayday, Mayday. It's late in the game. It is really late in the game. I could talk at length about what's happening. I understand what's happening in the world. Had a real epiphany today. But you know, talking about it isn't going to change it in the slightest bit. Not at all. What we need is the remedy. All right, truly the remedy. And the remedy starts with being able to have an overview of existence and to, through that overview, to not condemn what's going on. Because if you get into a condemnatory state of mind, there is going to be no end to it. Because it is really getting crazy out there, I am telling you. It is simply awful. So, is it possible to not get in a condemnatory state of mind? The answer is yes, it is. It is possible. Is it easy? No, it's not. That's why we're in a race against the situation. Can we elevate our understanding sufficiently so we can be in this peaceful, forgiving, non-condemnatory state of mind in spite of what's taking place? That is the ultimate challenge at this that we're faced with. It's on our plate. So there is an answer to that. There is a way to see it. The way to see it is that every has a plausible necessity to it, born from ignorance. Ignorance from the fact that we can choose a different idea. So with ignorance that we can choose a different idea comes this plausible necessity of defending against actually mental chaos, which symbolizes annihilation. With self as prime creator. The fact is that spirit and the prime creator are one reality, is one indivisible whole. If you're trying to get rid of, displace the prime creator, you're also trying to displace spirit. And displacement of reality would actually have to be an annihilation of reality. So spirit's really trying to annihilate itself. And it's defending against this annihilation through the usage of time, which is simply imagining that there's something prior to effects being experienced from an idea. Reality is there's an idea and its effects, they're one. There's no gap between them. So spirit doesn't want to be annihilated, even though it cannot. It can imagine that it's possible, or what if it's possible. And then it says, oh my gosh, this is terrible. I got to imagine that there's something before the effects are felt of an idea. There's something called time, which is a gradual building up of this effect. It's like the effect hasn't taken place yet. Like little tremors before the big earthquake, that kind of thing. So we have all these little tremors going on. Tremor, tremor, tremor. And trying to release the pressure of the big quake that we fear is coming, the big quake of annihilation. And that's time. All these little trauma. And sometimes we have a kind of a big foreshock, as it were. And which is what's coming up in this world, a rather large foreshock. And the fact is that all of this is plausible, has a plausible necessity to it. If we believe that this idea only is and work with, of course, it would be necessary to defend against mental chaos, and everything we're doing then would be perfectly sane, actually. However, because we are not stuck with that idea of wanting to be prime creator, displace God and be prime creator, we're not stuck. That was just one silly, whimsical idea, and we can set it, exchange it for another idea any instant, any moment. That will always be the case. We're not the slightest bit stuck. We're completely free to choose once again. And because of that, everything that's going on here doesn't have any real necessity. Okay, not any real necessity. It has a plausible necessity, born of ignorance. So that is the way to look at the world without condemnation. Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Okay, that's it. Forgive them because they know not what they do, which is very true. They're vast ignorance of the situation, of what is time, and ignorance that we can choose a new idea. You see, we think that the idea that we're prime creator, that idea, if we dropped it, then we'd be annihilated. That's the false notion. Because we know God dropped the idea of creation, there would be complete annihilation. So we think, since we think we are prime creator, if we drop the idea of us being prime creator, we think, oh, there must be annihilation. Forgetting the fact that all of this is just a what-if scenario, and we could never be prime creator. Forgetting that fact. So we're in a state of severe forgetfulness, ignorance, and fear, and defensiveness, etc. And out of that strange brew comes this plausible necessity to manage loss, limit loss, and manage this limit of loss. And to try and get rid of anything at all, anything and everything that points to setting this idea down, setting time down, and exchanging it for timelessness. And that's what we're in right now. You might say there's a severe paranoia in the world. There's an exchange phobia going on. Exchange-phobics. The world is full of exchange-phobics. They have this phobia about exchanging hypotheticals, about exchanging ideas. A severe phobia. And that's not always been the case. We all have it to some extent. But we can get over our phobias. I used to have the most incredible phobia about spiders. It was truly ruining my life. If I saw the slightest evidence of it, even the tiniest little spider anywhere, I would refuse to be in the house or anywhere where that spider was until I was sure that it was gone. And if I come in the room, I'd be shaking and sweating and trembling and just terror. And it was just, I realized it was controlling my life. And one day I realized I can't go through life with this phobia, because it's my life is going to be just terrible on top of everything else. And so I vowed then and there, I said, okay, I am going to cure myself of this phobia. And I think I spent about 6 months gradually desensitizing myself to spiders, tiny little step at a time, tiny. One of them is I would distance from it and not run away from it. Gradually shorten the distance. And eventually I overcame the phobia of spiders. So whereas now they don't even bother me. If a spider can come down on my head or something, I'll just shake it off like it's nothing. I mean, the phobia is gone. Totally eradicated. Which was quite amazing, because it was just a devastating phobia. So we have this exchange of phobia, and that is the real phobia the world needs to be focused on. Exchange of phobia, the fear of exchanging ideas, thinking that if we do that we'll be annihilated, which is completely an unexamined point of view. Entirely unexamined, a phobic point of view, exchange a phobic point of view. So what we need to do is we need to pull all these threads of distraction in the world, pull them into a thread of consideration that is truly relevant, and that is the exchange of phobic problem that we have in the world. Because from that phobia, there's everything in the world which is an attempt to eradicate any and all thinking and institutions that have to do with making this exchange, that say, tell us, hey, look, this is, we can't, it's our responsibility, that we must do it at some point, which is also true. We can't forever just be cowering in terror of annihilation. We weren't created for that. So our responsibility here is to make effective consideration of our phobia, and to dispel it, to dispel our severe fear. We have severe fear here, but instead we think now that we need to, the way to salvation is to get rid of any consideration whatsoever of making this exchange of time for timelessness, and to worship time. So what you have in this world right now are time worshippers. And we're heading into May. The last four nights I've had extraordinary dreams. They're so extraordinary I really can't even explain them. All I know was last night I was engaged with some spiritual teacher and some spiritual teaching, a gathering, and it was just, I can't even explain what was happening. I was getting instruction and giving answers, and it's just like, whoa, wow, what is going on? Then I couldn't remember where my car was, but just intense, intense dreams. Something big is coming up. So May going to be the month, okay, where you could just feel things begin to just crumble as far as restraint towards managing the exchange of phobia. Instead, people will try to worship time and give in to this exchange, this terrible phobia that they have, and decide, you know what, let's just get rid of any and all advocates for freedom and deliverance. Let's just wipe the earth clean and let us be free of inner terror that we might set time down and experience annihilation, which is a false conclusion, actually. The trends are overwhelming. The trends are overwhelming. And it's moving so fast. The river is moving so fast. So I expect in May to be the pivotal month. The pivotal month that we have been preparing for. And we could experience quite an amazing time, an amazing month. Something that's unexpected, and yet something that we can handle. Now, it's very interesting how the Holy Spirit uses time for us to help free us from time, actually. And what it gets us to do seems to be some understated wisdom to it that we don't understand. I was guided to plant a garden this year, and to do it very early. Had it all done March 16th. And I said, wow, that's too early. You know, it's going to be a problem. I bet your plants are going to be stunted and all this problem. You know, just like, wow, I don't know why I'm doing it so early, but I'll do it. Well, ever since I planted in that garden, it's been 70 degrees or more, except I think for one day, for a month and a half. In fact, it's been summer-like for the last two weeks. And this week, it's blistering hot. It was 94 yesterday. Today was 85, cooled off a little bit. Tomorrow, it'll be up, maybe upper 90s, mid to upper 90s. Thursday, again, could be even upper 90s where I am. And then Friday, it could be low 90s, and Saturday, lower 90s. Dropping down on Sunday into maybe the mid 80s or something. We're talking about just a blistering heat wave. The garden is just cooking. I mean, the plants are like 5 feet tall. The tomato bushes are 5 feet tall. Their tomatoes setting. They're showing signs of ripening. And I'm saying, like, my gosh, this is unbelievable. I've never seen anything like it. Squash. There's just a ton of squash on all the squash plants. The pepper plants are putting out peppers all in flower. And it is still April. So what is this all about? I'm experiencing a situation of maturity and flowering and soon harvesting before that it's time, as it were, before what we're used to. So something happening ahead of time, And this is somehow getting me ready for something, for a really big situation that's going to come up that will flourish in a way that people will think, wow, that's really ahead of its time. It's amazing. People are just to stop, walk along the road and stop and look at the garden. They're commenting on it like, wow, what's going on here? What? Most people haven't even planted their gardens yet. And this thing is just like, you got tomato plants that look like they're going to be tomato trees. It's just incredible. So I'm getting used to all that. I'm getting used to people stopping and staring and commenting. Like, whoa, this is just like flourishing so early. An early flourishing. Okay. All right. Now, what is that getting us ready for? It is getting us ready for some sort of deliverance situation here in the world that will flourish prior to early on in troubles, the time of troubles, early on, and will be very strong and profound. And people will like just say, whoa, this is amazing. How could this be all going so great so early? You know, I think most people know the tribulation period is coming, but they are not thinking along the lines of something full on salvational deliverance situation, just full bore early on. And this thing just cut out, but let me see if I can get it back. All right. And yet, I believe that's what's going to happen. And so this garden and the flowers, they're just, you know, just flowers everywhere. And it's just like summertime. And it is. The weather is like a summer heat wave. And it's just, never experienced anything like it in California. No way. 56 years here. It's never been like this. Never had a spring like this. Where it's this hot for this long. Such a warm and hot month that tomatoes are ripening and growing large. It's like I have a cluster of early girl tomatoes. I think it's like 8 of them, and you know, one of them is getting almost a mature size, and it's starting to turn color a little bit. Actually, tomato setting and growing to their mature size. So, an early maturity, an early flowering, something that's hits the ground running right as the tribulation period kicks off in earnest. That is what we have to look forward to. I mean, the dreams I'm having now are just something that's pointing to a big change, a shift in emphasis, something that is really going to be like a new experience for us. But we're ready for it. We're ready for it. We prepared for it. The light is really going to make its presence felt here. Because it is very important to safeguard the momentum towards consideration of exchanging time for timelessness. In those who are oriented in that direction, it's very important that they get support. There's support for that. And how this plays out will be something quite unique, I am sure. Quite unique in history. I don't believe that there is really much of a pattern for it, of what is going to take place. And there will be some incredulous people. There will be incredulous people. Because they say, well, this is a little too early for all this to be happening. No, it's not. It's not. Again, I planted the garden early on the calendar, and from statistical norms throughout history, you'd say it was early. But for this particular year, it was exactly the right day to plant. Hit it right on the very day. Perfect. So, for this particular situation that's coming up in the world, we're going to hit it on exactly the right day, with exactly the right intensity, for this particular situation. And that's going to be something. The key is to get on a positive vibe instead of reactionary vibe. We have to stop reacting to what the world is doing going on here. That's passé. It's passé. Why do we need to keep reacting to exchangeophobes? Exchangeophobics. Phobes. Phobia of salvation. And you can come up with your own phobias that's going on in the world. Why should we have to keep reacting to that? Why be reactive to it? Be proactive instead of reactive. You know, we could not cater phobias. Just like people could not cater to my phobia because I'd see, wherever I saw a spider, there's spiders everywhere. I cannot have people removing every evidence of spiders in my life. It's up to me to get over that phobia and realize I've got a problem. Instead of projecting on everybody else and saying they have a problem, they need to make my life free of spiders. No, that's unrealistic, not fair. So the people who are suffering from this exchange of phobia, they need to, you can call it deophobia, a fear of deity. They have a tremendous fear of a deity. But exchange of phobia is practically, they're afraid to make the exchange, they're afraid to even think about it. They're just assuming it would be annihilation without even looking at it at all. So it's a blind, faith-based phobia with no evidence whatsoever. And it's driving them. It's in control. They're in the passenger seat. So the fact is that the people in this world that are suffering terribly on this exchange phobia are not driving. They're like a passenger. And they're being driven by this phobia. The phobia is in all of them. And they're saying all these things, and everything, you know, that they come up with is just so characteristic of someone in the grips of a terrible phobia. And so obvious. So they're like prisoners of this phobia. Okay. But since they're not driving, you know, we need to get out of the way of this vehicle that they're driving, because the phobia is driving it. And we don't want to get run over by this car that's really careening out of control. So of course we make sure that we get out of the way. Without condemnation. When someone's in the grip of like a terrible, terrible nightmare phobia, you know, we have compassion for them. We get out of the way. We don't let them harm us, for sure. We get out of the way with tolerance, with compassion, with forgiveness, and see what we can do. Of course, we have tolerance and compassion for ourselves too, so we also look out for our safety as well, and see what we can do eventually. Help support their efforts to free themselves from this phobia. But nobody can free it for you. You have to do it for yourself. Nobody could free me from the spider phobia, the arachnophobia. Nobody could do it. And I realized that I was stuck. Which is it's something we have to take responsibility and just make a decision. You know what? I'm responsible for this, and I've had enough of this. I'm not going to keep living this way. So eventually, those who are suffering from this terrible phobia, exchange of phobia, will realize, you know what? I'm just tired of living this way. There must be some way to get free of this. And of course, there is. And those who have gotten free of it show the way. You know, I could see other people who did not have arachnophobia, and I said, how come you don't have arachnophobia? What's the matter? Why? Why is it me and not you? So it's very important that when you have a phobia, that you be around others who do not have it. Very important. Otherwise, you will start concluding that it's normal. So the problem is all these exchange of phobias are clustering together now, encircling the wagons and getting into this clique. Where that's all that they ever associate with are should have the same phobia. And they are starting to believe it's normal. The way they are is normal. And anything that anyone who doesn't have this phobia, they see that's totally abnormal. They must be crazy. Dangerously crazy. That's the problem. They get a persecution complex. When people suffering from severe phobias end up creating groups and cliques and all of that, encircle the wagons, they then get a persecution complex and feel that those who don't have the phobia are out to persecute them and destroy them, you know, and they must attack, that kind of thing. So they're on the attack, they'll be on the attack. And those who don't have the phobia have to be wise enough to see what's going on and say, no, they're just out of their minds right now, reasoning through fear. And phobic reasoning is not clear reasoning at all. It has all sorts of projection going on. All sorts of projection. Displacement, projection. Say, oh, you know, and distortion. And feeling they need to attack to prevent, to save themselves from destruction and all the stuff, which is just lunacy. So those who don't have the phobia have to be wise. They have to say, oh my God, there's this large, large contingent of exchange of phobomaniacs who are projecting, who are insane, temporarily suffering from temporary insanity, and are not reasoning clearly, and they think that somehow we're out to destroy them, which is a complete false conclusion. And yet, because they are temporarily insane and seeing it that it is a dangerous situation for those in harm's way who don't share the phobia. It really is. And we may need to relocate to a place out of harm's way, just so they don't act out their phobic delusions. So we need a soft landing into safety. You gotta know whether you have a phobia or not. It's easy to tell. The very fact that you can consider these ideas and this talk and stuff and say, yeah, that's interesting, I like that, it might be true, and you don't feel all disturbed and freaked out, and you're able to think along those, think and consider it and say, well, I like it. Maybe I don't understand all of it, I don't agree with everything, but that's okay, I'm not very disturbed, then obviously you don't have a phobia. Because the ones that have phobia, it won't listen at all, or if they do listen, they'll freak out. And they'll demonize, and they'll go in hiding, and there's a massive wall. They built up a massive wall that's defending itself from any inclination of to even consider exchanging time for timelessness, to even consider what time is, to even consider where did time come from, where did impermanence come from, why are we experiencing this, who are we, what's our purpose, all that stuff. They can't even consider it. It's too dangerous to them because they're afraid they might recognize what's going on and say, hey, I don't like this. I can set it down. And they think, oh my gosh, if I set it down, I'll be annihilated. So they don't even want to consider anything about it. They want to stonewall it. Stonewall it. Completely. And so that's an exchange of phobiac. As a stonewalling attitude to the whole thing. Whereas those who don't suffer from the phobia can just sit quietly, listen, and pick up some stuff here, pick up some stuff there. Say, oh, I like that. This, not so much, but this here, yeah, that's really not really good. And just like that. No worries. So there's a huge difference, now, a huge difference in the world between the two camps of those who don't have the phobia and those who do. And a phobia is you know how it goes. Like for me with the arachnophobia, I knew when I was over it. Now I still didn't like spiders so much. Who does? But I'd momentarily start, but eventually I didn't even start. I just like see it and say, ah, okay, come on, get out of here, run along. I don't really want you hanging around here. But there wasn't this grip, you know. Didn't grip me. The fear didn't grip me anymore. So I knew the phobia is gone. Still didn't like spiders, so now I'm not bothered. Some of them are, you know, maybe a little cute and interesting, but yeah, it's just no big deal. So when you have a phobia, you're gripped with this dread. You're gripped. It grips you. There's a dread that grips you. And you feel like it's stronger than your reason. There's something that's overpowering your reason. You say, why? It's not reasonable for me to be gripped. That is a phobia. I have allergies today. It's something just really amazing. I usually don't get anything like this, but this spring has just brought out everything. Everything is growing like crazy, like it's the final spring in history. It's like putting on the biggest show ever. I mean, the lushness. Tomato plants are scaring me. They're so lush. They're so lush. It's just like, holy cow. It's just crazy. You think like one day wake up, you like overgrow your house. You know, the way they're growing so fast. How tall are they going to get? I don't know. They're probably going to go 10 feet or something. I'm going to need new cages. I'm going to have to double stack the cages probably. Might have to do that. Put a cage upside down on top of the ones I have now, and to keep it going. I don't know what I'm going to do. It's just going right past the top of the cages, like no signs of slowing down. It's still April. Well, what are they going to look like in June or July? I don't know. Gee. Wow. So, an early start to our deliverance is going to bear fruit early on and abundantly, and it's going to bring about a tremendously ripe situation for down the road. Now, facts about what it's going to be, I don't know. There's something developing beneath the surface. There's no question something's developing. The world has been laying low. Everything's been laying low for quite some time, a long time now. It's just amazing that we've been into this dormant period for so long, and now it's going to heat up, and it should just bring suddenly a bloom, a big bloom. I'm just waiting for the spiritual teachers, you know, to come out of the closet. That's the real closet. That's the important closet. Coming out of the spiritual closet is the real coming out that the world is waiting for. Of those who stand for deliverance from exchange of phobia, from this horrible nightmare, hypothetical of what if reality is not permanent, and fear of a terrible defense against annihilation by trying to make time permanent, trying to dwell in time forever, and the attempt to limit loss by constant, gradual loss of this death, everything gradually dying, stuff coming into the world, stuff leaving the world, this whole assembly line of sacrifice, ghastly night. Fact is, why we quote-unquote like existence and time is because the alternative is even worse to our minds. From our way of thinking and our ignorance, we believe the alternative, we have no defenses against annihilation, is so much worse than time that we say, hey, I kind of like time. You know, I kind of like this dying and sickness and impermanence. I kind of like getting up in the morning feeling all achy and pain and arthritis and can hardly move and feeling exhausted. I kind of like that because it sure is better, sure beats the alternative, right? That's the sole foundation of our, how we feel towards time and existence is based on this relative scale of, well, it sure beats the alternative. That's it. There's nothing about existence that is actually likable, that we like at all. Nothing about it. Nothing about impermanence that truly touches our heart and we say, ah, this is what I really want. Nothing. It's all relative, saying it sure beats the alternative. I know sometimes people ask, you know, you ask, how are you doing today? He says, well, you know, I'm alive. It sure beats the alternative. And that's about it, right? So we go on and on and on and on and on with time, feeling terrible, disliking it immensely, suffering so terribly, and yet we hold our heads up and say, we feel so fortunate that we're able to have this instead of this mental chaos, total mental chaos, which symbolizes annihilation. And that seems reasonable enough. However, it's not really reasonable because we could easily be through with both time and mental chaos, both of them together. We could set them down. It all comes from just one silly idea. And we could exchange it for another idea, the idea of not trying to be prime creator. So all the suffering stuff is very silly, actually. Easily saved, easily delivered from it. Deliverance is easy. May is going to be the month. For me, it starts out on a very amazing note. May 2nd. May 1st, of course, International Workers' Day. That should be an interesting one in Europe and around the world with all the unemployment, etc., etc. So things may kick off with a bang. May 2nd, for me, is the memorial service for George Jones, which for me is an amazing event. I still can't believe that he's gone, because the man seemed indestructible. He was one of those people, you feel he's going to live forever. He's going to outlive you for sure. Because he's just so incredibly tough. And you just don't think that, you think time's going to make an exception for anybody. It's going to make an exception for George Jones. But it didn't. It didn't make an exception. So I'm going to be listening to that on, what is that radio? WSM, 650 AM online, something like that. They're going to broadcast it live from the Grand Ole Opry. So that is the end of an era, actually. The end of an era. And a lot of people feel that this is an American icon who symbolizes an era. A more rural era. A simple era. An era of being able to speak directly, that was free of political correctness, that was free of complex bureaucracy, that just was just based on, hey, just treat people right, that's all. Do the best you can, treat people right, and let's all get along and do the best we can and realize that this world is suffering. It's a place of suffering, and let's be compassionate with one another and not demand too much of one another. It was a completely different era, and he was the voice of that era. And so that voice has now been silenced, and they'll lay him to rest on May 2nd, Nashville, Tennessee. And that is, I'm going to listen to it online. Can't get it on television. We don't have this dish or dish TV or direct TV or it's being shown on both direct and dish TV on something like RF TV or RRTF TV, something like that, rural something TV. So that's May 2nd. Very significant day. There'll be a ton of people paying attention to that funeral. As a matter of fact, President George W. Bush is going to be a pallbearer in this service. I mean, that's how important George Jones is. The president is going to be your pallbearer. A lot of people have no idea who George Jones is, but those who do know realize that a mighty oak, a larger than life figure, supremely talented singer and artist. And just an icon, American icon. So we're going to have that. Now, not getting to what else is going to happen in May, but I have seen some stuff. There is going to be some stuff happening. I don't want to say exactly what, because we'll find out soon enough. And the idea is to be gentle on all this, to not react to all this, to have our attention focused more on our deliverance than reacting to exchange of phobiacs and all the stuff they do and see and how they reacted and running around like chickens with their heads cut off. You know, you just don't want to react to that. One of the ways I used to escape reacting to the world was I just put on some George Jones. Is that a mosquito? I think it is. I'm afraid it is. And I just listened to it. Listened to all the songs. He's trying to come in the back way here. Trying to sneak up. And just listen to that music. And, poor white man's blues, as it were. Poor white people's blues. and didn't really feel like I needed to pay attention to the world at all. But now we need something. We need something even better right now. Because the scope of what's going on now is titanic. It is really titanic. And so we have to be able to focus on our deliverance somehow. Not just to say, oh yeah, how awful, it's real rough, I got the blues. No, it's worse than having the blues. We've got these exchange of phobiacs foaming at the mouth. You know, looking at us with their beady eyes, sweaty brow, and trembling, and pointing and pounding the drum, saying, there they are, there they are, there they are. So that's not a good situation. So we need something to help lift us up above reactivity, above reacting to this, so we can be happy. We have a right to be happy. We have a right to be happy. We don't want to constantly be pestered by, you know, mosquitoes. There's all these mosquitoes going around. I don't want to be pestered by them constantly, right? You want to be in a mosquito-free environment. We have a right to that. We have a right to that. We have a right to be in an environment that's an exchange of phobiac-free environment. All right, where there's not a bunch of exchange of phobiacs frothing at the mouth, thinking that you somehow are out to get them. You know, paranoid, persecution complex. They have this extremely strong persecution complex that they think that everyone's out to get them just because not everyone shares their phobia. They think that if you don't share their phobia, you're out to get them. No, we're just simply saying, hey, you're acting in crazy ways. You're not using your time in the right way. You're missing your opportunity. You're really pulling yourself into more and more fear, and you need help. You know, you need to get over this phobia. And they don't take that admonishment or right. They think it's some kind of attack upon them, and it's not. I always respected people, even though I didn't quite agree with the kind of emphasis they put on those people who were like witnessing for Jesus, witnessing for their religion. I always respected them. I said, wow, you got a lot of guts to do that. Because people are going like, you know, they don't, kind of like, whoa. But they say, have you been saved, you know? Have you thought about your sin? And today, you don't see that much of that going on. It used to be you saw a lot of that. Absolutely. People going around and say, have you thought about your salvation? Have you been saved? You know, have you been saved? You thought. And people say, what are they talking about here? What's their point of view? What's their emphasis? How do they see it? Etc. Listen, keep an open mind. Not put on by it, but you don't see it anymore. You don't see it anymore. It just not happening because people are so offended. The phobia grips them like a dread. Oh, you know, I might have to examine my life. Oh no, I can't do that. I'm too busy persecuting those who are out to get me. I'm too busy passing laws and binding everyone to this future where we'll be free of all that. It'll be illegal. Where considering salvation will be illegal. It'll be a war against the righteous. You know, the war against those who know better. And we must end this war by re-educating everyone really entirely inappropriate to witness anybody salvation. I've been reading a lot of comments on George Jones' Facebook page there, and all over the internet comments, and they're all pretty much the same, and it's just amazing, absolutely amazing, blows my mind. I mean, talk about if you want to talk about someone's loved, you talk about George Jones. I mean, you just don't hear anyone say a bad word about him. And the people say, look, I'll tell you, say, George, I'm going to love you till the day I die. I'm going to keep listening to your music till the day I die. That's pretty much the gist of it. And that's amazing. You don't get that these days, do you? Can you talk about somebody that's just like universally, it's just loved, and people just say, you know, I'm always going to love you. You know, and it just... Well, where do we get that? You know, everything's so politicized now. Right? It's so politicized. See, Jones was beyond politics. Now, you're a good boy, you know, so you probably call him a patriotic conservative type. But he was beyond politics. He was an artist. What he was about was singing. That's it. That's all he was really about was singing. Yeah. Everything else, no, it's just the singing. It's just the music. It's just the sensibility. And people just love that. So these days, where do you find someone who's not a polarizing figure at all? I don't know. I can't really think of one off the top of my head. You just don't think of asking George, what do you think about this polarizing social issue? What do you think about, what's your stance on that? You just don't ask him that, you know, because it's not about that. You know, it's not about that. So we just, people have the sensibility, just let it be. Don't drag politics into a great artist's life. If, you know, if they don't want to be out there with that, don't drag it into the situation and polarize and be divisive about everything. Just leave well enough alone. Does everybody have to be a politician? Does everybody have to have some strong, outspoken opinion about this issue or that issue? Can we not let some of it be, you know, and just accept, you know what? I don't have to have everybody agree with me. Or we don't need total agreement on these things. We don't need it. So why do we need to keep dragging everybody's opinion up and arguing and shouting at each other? Can't we just say, hey, we're never going to all agree. Let's sit down and listen to some Jones. Let's not keep rocking the jukebox, you know. I want to hear some Jones, something like that. You know, that's the sensibility. Hey, folks, let's not rock the jukebox. I want to hear some Jones. In other words, I want to chill out. I want to reach something within me that transcends all the politics, all the social issues and politics. I want to reach something deeper than that. Which is, you know what? Time sure is miserable. That's a good place to reach, as a matter of fact. I want to remind myself right now that time, just time itself, is miserable. Why is that? Because it carries with it a inescapable feeling of incompleteness, because time is a demand for incompleteness. It is basically saying, I'm incomplete. Time is a statement of incompleteness. Defending against the complete experience of annihilation, mental chaos. So it says, oh, this experience is complete, yet we have this incomplete experience, precursor. It's incomplete. That's the whole purpose of time, to be incomplete. So there is this inherent sense, feeling, sensibility of incompleteness in time. It's always there like a shadow. It's impossible to get rid of it within time. The only way one gets rid of it is exchange time for timelessness. That's the only way. So we need to chill out. Everybody needs to chill out, cool down, and start paying attention to this fact that existence will always be this feeling of incompleteness. We will never feel complete or satisfied with existence. And we need to stop projecting this dissatisfaction we have onto somebody out there and say they're the cause of my dissatisfaction. Their opinions are the cause of this dissatisfaction. That is called ignorance. That comes from exchange of phobia. It's ignorance. And we're capable of wisdom. We have wisdom. We're not human beings. We're spirit. We have all wisdom within us. human beings are just spirit imagining itself in time, okay? But spirit is not in time, actually. It's just imagining it. So we need to cool down, depoliticize everything, and just listen to some Jones. In other words, listen to the feeling within it that says, time is miserable. And it's always going to be miserable. And I know it. And I'm not running from it. I'm accepting it. This is the Christian idea. We're all sinners. That's what it means. Sinners means that there's this always a feeling of incompleteness with time. Original sin means this, what if there was time, hypothetical, that always, from its very origin, has this feeling of incompleteness. It did start out feeling complete and become feeling incomplete. No, it's always been the feeling of incompleteness from its very origin. It is the very idea, the notion of incompleteness. So of course it feels incomplete. And there's no way around that. Original sin, so we all are suffering from this. And we need to accept this, that we're all suffering equally. We're all suffering from the same toothache, as it were. And to stop politicizing everything and blaming others for our own misery, because our misery comes from time. It doesn't come from anywhere else. I don't care who you are. Your misery comes from time, period. Because there's either time or timelessness. There's no misery in timelessness whatsoever. It comes from time. And time comes from as a defense against annihilation. Annihilation comes from spirit wanting to become prime creator. Annihilation is not a real annihilation. It's an imaginary annihilation. And it's symbolized by mind symbolizing as total mental chaos. So time is a defense against that total mental chaos. And it's always going to feel incomplete, like it's incomplete mental chaos, not total mental chaos. And we need to get to that point. When you get to that point, you have a different perspective on people. You hate the sin and love the sinner. Because people do so many crazy things in the world to try and get this sense of completeness with time, so they can always hold on to time. The exchange of phobiacs do crazy things. So you hate the crazy things they do. You're not supposed to like it. But you love the sinner. You love the one who's under the spell of this phobia, under the spell of ignorance, because they're spirit too. They're spirit too. So is that a dichotomy? You don't have to love all the things that the exchange of phobiacs do, because they do very, very nasty things, and they insist that you worship time, essentially. They try to make time very attractive, which is not a good thing at all. It's not helpful. It actually drags down into worse and worse fear and terror and misery. Terrible misery. So we have every right to say no, we're not going along with the agenda. But that doesn't mean we hate the sinner at all. We say, we know that you're going to come out of your phobia at some point when you finally get so disgusted with it. When you're so disgusted with it, you'll finally say, hey, it's enough. It's like the alcoholic finally one day hitting bottom for the time. And they finally say, this is disgusting. I'm not going to live my life this way, period. That's it. I'm not going to do it. And in that moment, you know, the recovery begins. And they do recover, and that's it. Speaking of that, George Jones was one of the worst alcoholics ever. His dad was a raging alcoholic, an abusive, raging alcoholic. And he'd wake up in a rage. He'd come home, and he couldn't sleep. He couldn't sleep, and he'd get in a rage, and he'd wake up the kids, and the only thing that would calm down was George Jones, the little boy, singing for him. And he'd take a belt to whip George with the belt if George didn't sing. So George had to jump out of bed. He'd be sleeping when his dad would come home, and he'd have to get out of bed and sing for hours and hours and hours until his dad finally fell asleep. And he protected all the other kids from beatings by doing that. So if he's saying for his dad, it calmed him. His dad would listen. Just sit there and listen. And if he didn't sing, his dad would get very abusive and violent with the children. And maybe with the wife, I don't know. But it was a very scary household he grew up in. And he literally protected the household from, you know, terrible abuse by singing. And he could sing so doggone good when he was just a child that he was able to calm his dad down. And one of his relatives, might have been his dad's brother, uncle maybe, heard how good he sang and began taking him around. He was a preacher. A preacher had a circuit. Back then, the preachers had circuits where they go from town to town to town, different churches, town, and have hold services because they're one of the pastors for all the different rural churches. And so he would take this little boy, George Jones, a child, with him to each church that he went to and have the Lord sing in the church. And he could sing so good that the crowds came. And so this uncle, you know, kept saying, George, you got to go because that's the way I can pull a big crowd for the Lord and I can, you know, witness to them, etc. And so George would learn all these great country gospel songs by going to all these different churches as a child, singing for, you know, large numbers of people. He drew big crowds at these churches as a child. I think even before he was even a teenager. And then he would walk the streets of Beaumont. Why'd that click on? He would walk the streets of Beaumont playing guitar and singing barefoot as like when he was 10 or something. And he'd stand on a street corner singing. And he drew large crowds and people would throw money at him, at his feet. And he made like $20 a pop. He could make up to $20 a pop as a 10-year-old. Hey, that was a ton of money for a 10-year-old. That's like wealth for a 10-year-old. I guess his dad found out that he could do that. He said, hey, go in town every day and sing in town. So he grew up singing there, and then he was taken into honky-tonks to sing. He sang on buses, and the bus drivers let him ride for free if he just sang for the passengers. And so that's all he knew. He started out as just a child singing to try to calm his dad's drunken rages down. And he never stopped singing, 81 years. Calming everybody down, you see. That's the great thing about George Jones is when you listen to him, his songs, you calm down. You really need to calm down. And it helped my life out immeasurably. It's one of the biggest helps I've had in my entire life. Behind the great teachers like Jesus and Anandamayi Ramana Maharshi, George Jones is next in that next in echelon of help in my life, because he calmed me down. He calmed me down. His songs calmed me down. Because I was getting agitated about the way the world's going. I said, this is just terrible. And then I spent years and years and years just listening to his music and singing it and not really caring about the way that, you know, world was going. I said, let me just calm down here. So I can't help but think that the world could be helped out by listening to this, you know, to his songs. They're just, they have an effect on you, a medicinal effect, actually. You just chill out. You don't feel political anymore. You really don't. You don't feel like cursing somebody. You don't feel like demonizing somebody. You don't. Let live and let live, you just say, you know, let's agree to disagree. Let's realize there's, you know, we're never going to, that agreeing is not the point of it here. His salvation is the point of it. And that is true. Exchanging time for timelessness is the point, but the exchange of phobiacs, they think that everyone agreeing with one another is the whole point of existence, so that we can be happy with time. We just have to get everyone to on the same page and all agreeing this, on the same viewpoint on everything all down the line. They think that is salvation. It's not. The feeling of incompletion will still be there, same as ever. It just wastes your time. It's a waste of time. Now, I can't play the songs of Jones so much on these videos because the Nashville Cats got the copyright thing down pat, and they don't really like it when you do that. they can be very aggressive about their copyrights. That's a certain idiosyncrasy. And to them, you know, that's it's a living, so you have to respect that. But you can go online on YouTube, and there must be, you know, 500 of his songs on there. Just so many. You just have to search around. But the idea is that we need to all calm down. We need to depoliticize everything. We need a situation that we just say, you know what, we're not going to drag politics into the situation. That's up to each individual. They have to say, you know what, this is a situation I am going to set aside. I am not going to drag politics into this situation. Forget it. And if somebody tries to, people just say, hey, no, not here, not here. Whatever side of the aisle, you know, not here. We're not getting political here. This is not event-driven situation. We're not getting reactive to the world here. We're not getting reactive to it. We're cooling down here. We're cooling down. We're all cooling down, and we're all connecting with something deeper, which is an inherent dissatisfaction with time, and we're also connecting with a realization that we are not bound to time, and that setting time down is not a dangerous thing to do. It does not result in annihilation. That is, when we set time down, we're also setting down the idea of wanting to be prime creator and exchanging that for the idea of accepting reality as it is, which leads to what we call is bliss, an overlay. And we've gotten into that other times. I'm not going to address that right now, all the detail of that. But there is this completely diffuse feeling of safety and love and judgment and accepting everything as it is. That is the experience that inexorably part of the idea of accepting what we accept reality as it is, so accept it can't be changed. That has a feeling with it, too, a feeling of completeness. Just as time has a feeling of incompleteness, timeless has a feeling of completeness. Okay, so we are interested in experiencing this feeling of completeness. And it's not necessary for everybody to be on the same page on all issues in time in order to set time down. Not necessary at all. Doesn't matter what your views are in time, because the feeling of completeness will inevitably accompany that for everybody who chooses timelessness. The feeling of completeness is there always, just as the feeling of incompleteness is always there when you follow time, when you accept the idea of wanting to be prime creator, wanting to entertain that idea. Time defends against the feeling of total mental chaos. Feeling of incompleteness accompanies time, no matter what you do. That's why people jump from relationship, right? And why the teachings are, wisdom will say, hey, what relationship, stay with it. We know you're not going to be very happy. We know you're going to still be miserable. But accept the misery of time, and then spend your time considering exchanging it for timelessness, and stop putting all your energy into hopping from one relationship to another relationship. That really wastes your time, and at the end you'll realize, I'm just as miserable as ever. You know? So keep your life simple. Keep things uncomplicated so we don't have some vast bureaucracy which is becoming impossible for anybody to navigate, except the very young who are treating it like some kind of thrill ride. But they don't understand that as you get older, you don't want to go on the thrill ride so much anymore. And you can't navigate the bizarre complexities of it all. And cannot bounce back from all the bruises and reversals, etc., and the troubles that you can when you're young. They don't see that. So everybody needs to take a step back and all cool down. Everyone has to cool down. So we are praying for a cool down situation where people just say, no politics here, no reactivity, no, not event driven. It's not driven by, you know, the latest celebs and gossip and tabloid stuff and entertainment news and all this kind of stuff like that. It's not driven by that. We're leaving that pretty much out of the picture. And there's just a general sensibility. Everybody realizes, hey, we're it's not about that. It's not about that. It's about connection. Connecting at a deeper level. Feeling at a deeper level. Accepting the inherent miserableness of time. And say, you know what, I want to exchange time for timelessness. Let's get after that. Let's get after that. Let's do that. Let's find out what's the root of these phobias, you know, exchangeophobia. I need to cure myself of exchangeophobia. Because to some extent, we're all exchangeophobiacs except for those who've overcome it. And some have got it really bad now. So there's a lot of people in the world who have it really, really bad. And that's not good. That is not good. I said it's going to be a long, hot summer. I didn't realize it was going to start in April. And it really has. I may have to start eating watermelon the way it's going, you know, and watermelon in April. Tomorrow's going to be May 1st. So, yeah, I mean, I saw at a store today, they're selling watermelon. People are buying watermelon. that's usually in August or July or something, right? When it's like just been hot, you just say, I just got to get some cold watermelon. But we're feeling that way now. Today I wanted to buy some. I want to get some of that cold watermelon. I need some. Maybe tomorrow I will, as a matter of fact. So hopefully I didn't get chewed up by mosquitoes here. Hey, everybody, cool down. Cool down. Stop reacting to events. Stop getting inflamed. We don't have to constantly interpret what exchangeophobiacs are doing because we know they're suffering from extreme mental problems, actually. And they're not in their right minds. So we don't need to judge what they're doing, every little thing, and react to it, etc., etc. You just need to... don't get contaminated by it, and help them in the way that they can be helped, and certainly don't be hurt by them. Stay out of harm's way, sidestep the troubles, and no need to react to what they do. It's all futile. It's all coming from a place of ignorance, blind fear and confusion. And they're acting silly. You know, when someone's acting silly, sometimes the most compassionate thing you can do is just pay attention to them. Really, that is true. And I really feel that way with the world right now. The best thing to do is not pay any attention to it. Ultimately, the best thing to do is relocate, go somewhere else. And that's the most compassionate thing, is because then you're not paying any attention to it at all. And at some point, those who've been acting with this phobia driving their vehicle, they're going to realize, wow, I got to take the wheel from this maniac that's driving the vehicle. And they'll, at some point they'll say, I hope that nobody paid any attention to what I was doing back then because I was really crazy. It's like George Jones, he was such an alcoholic because he grew up in Beaumont with his dad, and it's just like drinking was like, that's what was done. Not just drinking a little bit, drinking to raging excess in that wildcat boomtown of Beaumont. So he was a raging alcoholic, and he just drank himself into just these, you know, complete oblivion, and but he could handle it. He could keep functioning, but he'd get into fights like all the time, getting into fights because that was normal for how he grew up. In the honky tonks, there were just terrible fights all the time. It was like the Wild Wild West, and so he has a terrible problem with alcohol and drugs and just whatever made him feel out of control or whatever, would get him in some zone that he couldn't seem to resist it. But eventually he kicked that addiction. He relapsed like one time. He decided to drink when he was driving one time, and he was reaching to change a cassette in the cassette player of his vehicle as he was driving at night, I think. And I guess he took his attention off the road to too much an extent. And there's this bridge with stone columns at the start of the bridge, and he went head on into one of these stone columns and just about died. And I don't think he ever took another drink again. That cured him. that's tough love right there. But up until that point, he had been sober for I think a long time. So he did kick his demons. He did kick them. But he had severe demons. So if he can do it, anybody can do it, as a matter of fact. So we can. Demons can be kicked, but sometimes it takes a really severe wake-up call, like Jones had crashing into that stone bridge. The world may need a severe wake-up call. They may need to go head-on into something, you know, before they just finally say, "Whoa, I gotta stop. I gotta get over this phobia I have, exchangeophobia, because time just is terrible. The time is very nasty. It's of course limiting loss, so you go through a lot of loss." It's not getting rid of loss, it's limiting loss. It's trying to have total loss. So you got to have all this partial loss constantly. So it's like basically constant trauma. Time is trauma, as a matter of fact. You give the time to the Holy Spirit, will use it to help free you from your phobia. But time is trauma. So we will... Sometimes, again, those who have a real bad addiction, sometimes they need to have that big wake-up call. You might say the world made an attempt to get over it, and what's happened is relapsed. Last 50 years, it relapsed severely, and so it's probably headed for that stone bridge. And, you know, we'll be there to pick up the pieces. You know, people forgave Jones. They were strong. They were harsh. You know, they said, "Hey, you really blew it this time." You know, and they weren't happy about it, but they stood by him. Said, "Look, you've got to never do that again," and he didn't. So they stood by him, but they, you know, it was tough love. And that's the way it's going to be in this world. I mean, we'll pick up the pieces. And we'll stand by everybody and offer them, you know, tough love. And hopefully they will decide to kick their habit. But again, to help them out, they're going to ask us, "Hey, did you see everything? Did I was crazy back then?" And we'll say, no, I wasn't paying any attention. So I knew you were out of control, so why should I, you know, pay attention to what you're doing and embarrass you that way? Anyway, it's not going to do that. I said, I just went somewhere else, and I wait until you sobered up a little bit. That's all. Now, not everybody sobers up right away. You got someone like Keith Whitley, who was really a really great singer of his own right. Alcohol took him to the grave. You know, there's plenty of people that alcohol takes to the grave. But sobering up is possible. The old possum, he sobered up. That's the name for George Jones. The possum, he sobered up. And boy, he was... touch and go. It almost brought him to the grave a number of times, actually. But he was such a doggone good singer that I think people say, hey, George, we don't want you to die. Okay, you got to stay around. You got to keep singing for us. So, you know, they wanted to save him. They really wanted to save him. So this is somebody that's worth saving. We're really going to make sure that he doesn't die. So friends helped him out, as a matter of fact. He was helped out. Not everybody's so fortunate. But keep in mind that those who have been freed time and accepted timelessness, they view everyone as a dear friend. So they've got your back. They've got your back, even though it may not seem like it. It may not always seem like it. For me, oftentimes I feel like no one's got my back. There's no evidence of it, you know. So, but I've got to at least believe that they must. But I hope so. I hope so. We'll see. So, May Day, May Day, May Day. We're headed into May. We're headed into the month of May, the fifth month, 2013. And it is bound to be the wild ride. It begins. The roller coaster ride begins. The amusement park ride begins. Don't react to it. Pray for something to help you, cool you out, cool you down. Just tell yourself, hey, I don't want to rock the jukebox. That means that famous song by Alan Jackson, don't rock the jukebox, I want to hear some Jones. My heart ain't ready for the Rolling Stones. Meaning, don't play, you know, in your life, don't hit that button on the jukebox that says the Rolling Stones, hit the one that says George Jones, because you'd rather listen to that. You're not ready for rock and roll. You don't feel like it. In the world, it means you don't really want to react to all the rocking and rolling of the times as it all disintegrates and falls apart. You don't want to react to it. You'd rather be listening to something that takes you to a deeper place of realization, that cools you down. So, we say, hey, don't rock the jukebox. I want to hear some Jones. That's a nice catchphrase. I want to hear something a little slower. I want to slow down. I want there to be some time to think about what's being said. I want it to be mellower, smoother. I want it down low. Something that takes me out of fever of the world, from the feverish pitch that the world is in right now, of everybody screaming at each other. You know, enough of that. I don't want all that rock and roll like that. So, all right, I think I'll go inside and go listen to some Jones. literally. I can put it together, a playlist for you on YouTube. I already did, as a matter of fact, on this channel. If you look down below the video, there's a playlist that George Jones, there's just a few of his songs. There's hundreds of them. And I can add some more. And just feel free to listen to the playlist. You know, some of them have commercials. You can just, after 5 seconds, you can hit, you know, skip this commercial. And if you feel like just cooling down, which we got to do, just think about, hit play all, and go down the playlist and play all, and just let the playlist play in the background, and just see if you can't cool down. Maybe something will touch you and say, hey, I like this sound, I like this slower cool down sound that's just kind of mellower and touches me somewhere about the misery of time. Oh yeah, I remember the misery of time. Yeah, that's right. It's miserable. And it's inherently miserable, right? And then you start getting wise, and that's great. So, all right, this is the May Day special video. Get us all. Try listening to the playlist of George Jones, and don't rock the jukebox. I want to hear some Jones. That's it.